Мы готовы продолжить нашу работу. И я хочу предоставить слово новому члену правления нашего института, господину Стивену Даггану. Он представляет стратегических и долгосрочных партнеров ЮНЕСКО, компанию Microsoft. Он является директором по всемирной стратегии в области образования Microsoft, Worldwide Education Strategy in Microsoft Corporation. И его доклад «From now to next, how new pedagogies and technologies are delivering on the promise of personalized learning». Это очень важная тематика, которая также близка нашему институту, связанная с проблемами персонализации обучения, что сегодня также одна из важных тенденций в области применения ИКТ в образовании. Пожалуйста.
Is the sound? Okay. Good morning, or good afternoon now. My name is Stephen Duggan, and it's a great honor and a pleasure to be here. I'm going to just, I should warn you, because I work for a technology company, if something goes wrong with the technology, it'll happen to me. This is what happens always. So, I just go here. That's a good start. As I said, my name is Stephen Duggan. I work currently in Microsoft with a focus on building and serving partnerships focused on delivering improved educational outcomes. I work with industry bodies, people like Intel and some of our other colleagues who I know are here today, but also largely with not-for-profit and multinational organizations. I manage, for example, our relationship with UNESCO. I also work with very large NGOs such as World Vision, Save the Children, and many others. But first and foremost, I'm a teacher. I joined Microsoft straight from the classroom. I taught English language and literature for 12 years. I spent my days trying to convince children that Shakespeare would change their lives. I hope it did. I hope it changed it for the better. And I'm also a parent. I have 6 children. I have 3 boys and 3 girls. Thank you very much. I think that's for my wife. She deserves the credit. We have 6 children, a boy, a girl, a boy, a girl, a boy, a girl. Yes, my wife is a very organized person. Yes. And we have three with brown eyes, 3 with blue eyes, 3 dark-skinned, 3 fair-skinned, 3 light-haired, 3 dark-haired. She's an incredibly organized person, but it needs one in every household. So my interest in education is not just professional. It's also very much personal. 2 of my children have severe learning difficulties. One of my children is dyslexic, and the other has ADHD, OCD, Tourette's syndrome, auditory processing difficulties, and sensory processing difficulties. He does not like school, but we're hoping things will change and there'll be smiles returning to his face as well. But what I'm going to talk to you today about is this challenge of how we moved from knowing where we want to go to actually getting there. So we hear this phrase, personalized learning, discussed a lot. But it's really unclear what we really mean. And also it's unclear to a degree how we actually achieve this. One of the pleasures of my job is I get to go around the world going into classrooms. And a good game to play at this stage is try and spot the happy face. Okay? Because what you find is that although the classrooms can be very different in the age of the equipment, or maybe the number of kids in each class, the pupil-teacher ratio, or various other dynamics, what strikes you most is how similar they are. From one corner of the globe to another, we see much the same thing. And as our esteemed colleague said earlier, really nothing much has changed. And largely this is because classroom design and systemic design tends to start in the wrong place. It starts with a physical space. And then maybe we add some place for children to sit. And then we add some content and resources, a place for the teacher to sit or stand. And then we add in some technology. And it is very much the case of the more. We add the technology. But what we don't tend to do is start here. We tend not to start with the individual and build or construct the system around them. And one of the results of this is this rather startling research. This is a survey of how many children just like being in school. And what we see is, year after year, grade after grade, they like school less. Sir Ken Robinson talks about how a child enters a school wanting to be an astronaut, a vet, a professional football player, and something else. And they leave school wanting to be an accountant. I have nothing against accountants, but something fundamentally is wrong. And what we also see is that there is a slight upturn towards the end. When we get to grade 9, we see that the satisfaction ratings tend to go up. But there's a reason for this, and that's because a lot of students at that stage drop out. They leave school. And at that stage, we're only surveying those who have decided to stay by choice. So this is a profound dissatisfaction with the present. And it's not something that is unique to students alone. There is a massive amount of teacher dissatisfaction with the process and the system of teaching. Increased workload on teachers, increased administration and bureaucracy for teachers, but not increased job satisfaction. And that's something fundamental. So what we've discovered is we've entered into a new era in education. We know that the now, what we are doing now, is failing. And it's failing not just the students, but parents. It's failing the educators themselves. It's failing employers who cannot find the skills they need. It's failing entire communities and nations and economies. In fact, it's failing everyone. So there is a need at this stage. We've reached a tipping point where change is no longer something desirable. It has become something essential. And what we're also finding is that the reason for children to drop out has also altered. In the past, children left schools because they were failing. They were not able to succeed in that environment. What we're now seeing is an increasing number of students who are leaving school because school is failing them. It's not that they're not bright enough. They are. It's that they believe fundamentally that school cannot meet their needs. It does not resonate with how they learn, and it will not provide them with the futures that they desire. Now, this is a recent survey in the US where high school dropout rates are actually at an all-time high. So fundamentally, something has happened within the school system. The place which used to be a place of environment has become a place of darkness. I make the comparison that when I was a 17-year-old in school, I put down the book I wanted to read at the day of the at the door of the classroom and walked in and I picked up the book they wanted me to read. Now, when a child gets to the door of a classroom, they take out their life and they put it aside before they enter the classroom. They cut off the communication they've been having with peers and with others and enter a world which, for them, in many ways, is like stepping back in time. And it's not just failing the students, but actually there's a fundamental issue here. And that issue is that the skills being taught in schools are no longer the skills that are required. 2/3 of the jobs that children in high school now will do when they leave school don't yet exist. We don't know what they're going to have to do, but we do know the skills. The challenge is that the things that are easy to teach and easy to measure are the things we need least. There are some bright spots, and you know, obviously we should talk about technology. Here's an interesting statistic that Sal Khan from the Khan Academy shared with me when we met recently in Redmond in Seattle. I asked him a very simple question, is how many students are you reaching with your services? And he told me 216 million students in 1 year. 216 million students actually practicing flipped classroom modalities. What they're doing is they're looking at videos as a way of learning, and then they're going back and taking tests or taking assessments. But the most staggering statistic wasn't the number of students that he has reached, but the number of teachers he has reached that number with. 36 teachers in total. Khan Academy has reached 216 million students with 36 teachers. The power of technology to amplify the impact of a great teacher is enormous. The other big change he mentioned to me, and I asked him, you know, what one thing can you say has actually changed from the use of technology? And he said, that's easy. It's the definition of a slow learner. A slow learner in a typical classroom, like the classrooms I used to teach, is somebody who might find a concept difficult to grasp. And normally, in a typical classroom environment, a teacher teaches a concept once. The bright children, they get it immediately. The average children, they may need the teacher to repeat it a second time or maybe a third time. For the slow learner, they end up being left behind. Because after that third time, the teacher is under pressure on time and typically will have to move on. What Saul said to me is, with this sort of technology, a slow learner is just somebody who learns slowly. Because they can rewind that teacher 200 times if that's what it requires for them to understand the concept and then move on. That's quite profound. The notion that no child is left behind enabled by technology is a profound notion. But technology, of course, is no panacea. It's not a silver bullet. You know, as Michael Fullan said, the ability to learn does not just appear with the opportunity. If information was enough, then we would all be winning the Nobel Prize. Because in our pockets is a device which will give us every piece of information we require, every piece of information possibly on the planet. What we need is teachers. What we need is great pedagogy in order to translate this into new modalities. And in fact, the reality is that most ICT is used in the wrong way. When we survey schools and ask them how they're actually using the technology, very few of them are actually employing technology in classrooms to do higher order work. They're using them for the simple, fact-based or research-based tasks that really don't expose deep learning in a true sense. The good news is we now know what we want. We know what deep learning means. And although you may see a slide similar to this with slightly different language, the key concepts, global citizenship, problem solving, competency-based learning, self-regulation, self-assessment, all of these skills are now understood. We know these are the skills that we need people to leave schools and colleges with in order for them to survive and to thrive in a 21st century environment. Even more so, we know what we want to change. We know where we want to go from, and we know where we want to go to. We know that we're going to move away from teachers as sages on stages to guides by the side. We know that we're going to move away from any, you know, time-limited learning to anytime, anywhere learning. All of this is clear, but the challenge is, how do we get there? Well, this is the place where technologies can play a part. But as a teacher, I was always told that I should always try to show rather than tell. Can I just check, is the sound now working on the, before I play this video? Is the sound, is it? Yes, so I just plug this in. Yep. And, oh yes, okay. So I'm just going to show you a very short video, but I'm going to ask you to look at something while I'm doing it. And that's to, yes? And that's to look at the children and watch what they're doing and watch the teacher as well. This is a really, really, really simple use of technology, which is actually quite, quite instructive.
In my classroom, I'd be asked to find out new technology that can expand the kids' possibilities. Creator, come on up. Learning comes from a teacher that's willing to take a risk and do something new and bring in these powerful tools.
Hi, welcome to Mystery Skype.
One of the key tools we're using right now is Skype to connect with other classrooms. It's so powerful to connect them beyond these four walls.
Are you in the United States?
Mystery Skype's a chance for the kids.
Connect
with other students around the world.
Are you east of Mississippi?
Runners of
no.
Mountains. It's a challenging game for them. They have to critically think.
It helps the kids understand other cultures in other countries.
Are you in the U.S.?
No, we're not.
Are you somewhere in Mexico?
Yes.
It's a powerful tool to see kids learning from each other. Hey, Mateo, come on over, bring those maps. To see their critical thinking process is far better than any test I can give them.
Because of Mr. Bebley, learning seems to be really fun. It's more like a game instead of the teacher telling you this is what we're going to be doing.
It's a team effort to really win Mystery Skype.
Do the Rocky Mountains run through your state?
No.
I mean, really, it takes a team to do anything in life. And this is a chance for them to experience that collaboration.
Are you in Baja, California?
No!
You can see those light bulbs going off and just that connection that they're making. How better to do that than to actually connect with other kids all over the world?
Do you have dry weather?
Yes, we do have.
Technology empowers our class to be enabled to learn beyond our four walls. I'm just a passionate educator who wants to make an impact for kids. I'll take risks to try to expand their learning beyond what they could have ever imagined.
Are you in Mexico City?
Yes, we are.
So a very simple use of technology. All that happened, if you look at it, was there was one group of children talking to another group of children, trying to figure out where they were. But to do that, did you see the modalities they were using? They were doing research on their own, they were collaborating in groups, they were leading the learning, displaying all of those 21st century skills that we want to support. And that's where great pedagogy comes in. What the teacher was doing was directing that learning experience. And the part that technology played was actually very small. The classroom in Mexico City had one very old laptop with a camera. That was it. That was all the technology that was required. The classroom in the United States, there was laptops pretty much in every desk. But it wasn't a differentiator. It really didn't matter. What was key was the learning styles, the learning modalities being supported, and technology working as a scaffold. Because fundamentally, pedagogy is about these three things. It's about relationships between and among teachers and students and parents and system organizers. It's about practices and it's about measurements. And new forms of learning require new approaches to all of these. And one of the common complaints I hear about teachers is that teachers shouldn't teach to the test. Well, of course teachers teach to the test. That's how they are measured. And they will always do the thing that the children are going to be measured against. What we need is new measurements. We need new forms of assessment, new ways of measuring the new forms of learning. As a person working in the ICT industry, I work on global partnerships such as this one, which is the Collaborative Assessment Alliance, which is about identifying and putting in place new forms of measurement, new forms of assessment within schools to support that journey. I also work on a project called the New Pedagogies for Deep Learning Initiative. This is an attempt to find and model systemic change. It involves 1,000 schools in 10 countries around the world with the support of their ministries of education, looking to try and identify the best practices that are both replicable and scalable so that we can drive systemic change. So fundamentally, what we know is that the role of technology in education is not a black and white issue. But I'm going to move away from the developed world for a second, because in some times, it is. It's very black and white. When I began working with UNESCO, I spent maybe 8 or 9 months in a dialogue saying, what should we do? And my role is global education strategy. But the reality is, like most ICT companies, we only work in those parts of the world where you can plug a device into a wall, which is not global. So we asked the question of UNESCO and some of those leading NGOs, what issue should we focus on? And they were unanimous. They said the foundational issue in education is literacy. And it is literacy because literacy affects all of the things you see on the left of the screen. And the good news is, we know the things we need to improve literacies, and it's all the things on the right of the screen. We need more books, we need more teachers, particularly we need books in local language. We need more mentors and coaches. We need a sustainable model. But the scale of the challenge is one that surprised us. This is the number of illiterate adults on the planet. That is 1 in 4. 1 in 4 adults on the planet cannot read or write. And if we think that our school systems will improve it for the next generation, this is the percentage of children not in school today who will never go to school. 49% of children who are absent from primary school classrooms today will never attend a single hour of school in their lifetime. We also have a major challenge when it comes to language instruction. Literacy learning in a second language is very hard. It is much easier and it's much preferable to learn to read and write and to learn basic numeracy in your own language. But this is the number of languages we have on the planet. We have over 7,000 languages, and 95% of those languages are spoken by less than 100,000 people. So we listened to this, and then we were kind of mindful of another challenge. We were told that 31% of illiterate children live in illiterate homes. They live in homes when there's nobody who can read to them. For these children, providing them with a book is effectively as useful as providing them with a rock. It does not scaffold learning, it cannot support them. So we took that learning, and our view in industry is we are not the thought leaders. We should not have a role in directing educational policy. What we are is a very good toolkit. So we took that learning, and being mindful of this man's advice, Anton Chekhov's, knowledge is of no value unless you put it into practice. Chekhov is a favorite writer of mine. It's one of the thrills of coming here to Moscow for the first time is the chance I'm going to get to go to the Moscow Arts Theater. But as a result of that, we decided, well, what can we do? So what we did is we built a set of tools, which are on this website here, which allow anybody, anywhere, to write and publish a book in any language. We worked with all of the agencies you see on the screen here. We call the tools Chekhov, in veneration of that great writer of short stories. But these tools allow anybody on the planet to go to a website and create a story from scratch, but a story that will not only be expressed as a print book, but is also expressed as an app for tablets, PCs, computers, and mobile devices. A book, in other words, that will read itself aloud to a child living in an illiterate home. And the tools are very, very simple. They work on any browser. They allow people in areas of the developing world with very low infrastructure to go in there. They add text. They speak audio narration timed with highlighted words. And then they end up with books which will allow them to do that. I'm going to switch device for a second, and I'll see if it lets me. And, This is, as I said, where the technology gets difficult. And I'm going to share with you. As I said, it's always the technology person who has the problem with the technology. This is the screen of a mobile device. I'm just showing it to you here. This is a $59 device. That's how much it costs, without a contract. I bought this on a high street in the US before I came here. But actually what it is a really powerful computer. We need to forget about devices, at least the devices we know now. Devices are changing rapidly. This computer, this small mobile device, has Facebook and Twitter and Office and all of these things that we would only have seen on significant computers maybe 3 or 4 years ago. And it also has some of these texts, texts created on these devices offline by teachers in places like Lesotho. I'm going to show you very briefly what these little stories look like. This is a little story sitting on this device. And what you see is you'll get an image and some text. And if you touch the text, now this is where I have to get close to a microphone.
This is Ben. Ben is in a new home.
It's very simple technology, and I also can do what's called read it myself.
Home.
And I can click on a word.
Ben.
And it will read it aloud. Really, really simple technology, but the fact is that this device will hold 20,000 of those textbooks. But perhaps most exciting about it is what you can do with those books, because we collect analytics. So when people use these books, not only are they learning to read or having the opportunity to create reading objects, but also we're providing them with the opportunity to do it in any language. And in fact, people are writing these books in a variety of languages, including minority languages. I have books in languages like Sesotho sitting on my phone right now. But they're also using it to do different things as well. They're doing it, for example, to create health resources to support people who can't read and need that requirement. And we have children, as I said, in very isolated communities now using the device in their pocket to scaffold their learning, because this is where it gets exciting. We know for each individual student, when they have finished reading a book, how long it took them to read a book. We can assess their learning in the course of that, and we can direct them to the next book afterwards, all with the simple technology sitting in their pocket. And these are free resources. In fact, right now we have people every day creating new stories for free on this service to scaffold learning in their countries. And this is going to be the foundation of an agreement we're signing with UNESCO on Mother Language Day during Mobile Learning Week next year. So this is just a couple of the areas where we're working and some of the languages we're working in just over the next 3 months. So it's just an example of how technology sometimes can address learning in a very simple way. But when we look at ICTs and education in total, well, what does success look like? When we look further down the line, how will we know that we have moved forward in a significant way? Well, sometimes we think of places like this. This is a school called Telefonen School in Sweden. It's a wonderful school. I want to go there, let alone send my children here. It's a school built around the student, where it has learning spaces. You'll see there's support for all sorts of immersive, collaborative experiences. There's even a place that appeals to both the introverts as well as the extroverts for our visual, auditory, and kinesthetic and mixed learners. But in reality, maybe this isn't the place we need to look. When we need to look into the future, actually, I would suggest that rather than imagining a classroom of the future, a space-age classroom, we need to look back to this model. Because the reality is, we've always had a model for personalized learning. It used to be called the apprenticeship. And before the Industrial Revolution demanded that we put a large number of people into the same room with an instructor to teach them the same knowledge because they needed to do the same jobs, we had a model for individual instruction. Under the apprenticeship, you had constant change and tailoring of the learning to the learner. A master teacher who could watch and assess as that learner progressed and tailor instruction exactly to their needs to suit them and to ensure that they thrive and succeed in the past. This is the future of personalized learning. Often when people ask me what is the role of technology, I point out one simple thing. We cannot do this without technology. The only way in which we can measure in real time the learning journeys of 30 children within a classroom is to employ technology in an intelligent fashion. But we now have the tools to do this. The future is incredibly bright. The future not just for communities such as those using these devices. These are places, by the way, without electricity, without broadband. These devices work offline. In many cases, without physical classrooms and physical teachers. But for global learners, the opportunity for personalized learning is advancing and accelerating at an extraordinary pace. I hope this has been of interest to you. I look forward to meeting as many of you as I can over the next couple of days, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Stephen. Yes, yes, вопросы. If you have any questions, please. Pete, again. Microphone, please.
Thank you, Mr. Duggan, for this inspirational presentation. My question is a little bit to I would like to have your feeling about the two elements in your presentation. First is, I think, you show that the mood of the children and the social dynamics is so crucial for learning. And that's what we all pick up. And then you give an example of, like, the e-books. The teacher can see what has been read and what could be the next book for this student. So it is a little bit like instructional. Teachers are concerned about the sequence and the timing of the learning. And that makes me think a little bit, because for me, the really hurdle, the restriction, the limitation in innovation is that we still have the traditional assessment method. Students are evaluated individually on their skill, their knowledge, attitudes, strategies, whatever. But it's an individual measure. And if we promote the collaborative learning, we have the criterion of social dynamics. And it is that parents and students, they feel it is a little bit obsolete to invest in the social climate while the final accounting the final certificate depends on the individual production, reproduction, if you say. So what is your view on the future in terms of assessment?
So let me answer that in two ways. First of all, it's one of the great challenges of education. The question was how do we balance the individual and the collaborative? And the reality of school right now is that we take 30 children, we put them into a room and tell them they must learn to work together. And at the end of 14 years, I speak about, I'm from Ireland, the Irish education system, we then send them into rooms to compete against each other as individuals. That's a huge dichotomy. Something is broken. That's why we have such a focus on new measurements. We need new ways to assess the ability to collaborate and work with others, because that's the skill they'll be asked to show when they leave schools. But I'm also a pragmatist. And when I went into the classroom in Lesotho, where I showed a photograph from earlier in my presentation, I met a teacher who was teaching 156 children in that classroom. One teacher, 156 students. For her, traditional methodologies still had a role, because she didn't have the ability to embrace some of the new modalities, much as she would have liked to. She also had 15 textbooks between those 156 students. There's also another challenge in developing world countries, and that's that we can't rely on the formal education system. We don't have enough teachers. We're 1.7 million too few teachers to meet the goals of universal education by 2020. We're not going to get that 1.7 million extra teachers very quickly. And this is not a case of technology replacing the teacher, but there are places where technology can scaffold and fill the gap. And that's really what we've been focusing on as an industry. How can we provide more textbooks, more forms of real-time assessment? How can we address the challenge that so many girls aren't in classrooms at all? For cultural reasons, for other reasons, they're being prevented from learning. And if we can take something as simple as the device, I mean, there's 5.6 million of these devices on the planet. And I've met Maasai tribesmen who told me they didn't have running water, but they had a mobile phone. The mobile phone is becoming ubiquitous. Part of the question we're asking educators is, how can we turn it into something that can scaffold learning, at least in the foundational ways? So I agree with you, these are big dichotomies, and I think we're on a journey. But I think we also have to be mindful that the challenges in different nations are very, very different, and those nations that are at very different stages of that journey.
Thank you. И еще один вопрос. Sorry, lady.
Мы учим детей с использованием новых технологий. Они с удовольствием посещают уроки, они с удовольствием учатся, но в конце обучения у них создается иллюзия, что они обладают всеми теми знаниями, которые есть у них в мобильном устройстве. То есть создается иллюзия того, что они знают все, что есть в этом компьютере. И поэтому старшеклассник, который выходит из стен школы, он, как специалист, которого будет востребован, который на рабочем месте, мне кажется, он недостаточно состоятелен, потому что он не умеет сделать одну работу от начала до конца хорошо, без исправлений, и нести полную ответственность за сделанную работу. Поэтому вот как одну из глобальных стратегий, которую надо, наверное, внести на рассмотрение, это подготовка старшеклассника как будущего специалиста, который будет востребован на рынке труда.
Стивен, okay. Did you have translation or...
So, I'm sorry, I didn't bring this up to the podium in case there was, in case that happened. It's screaming.
Да, кратко.
Значит, вопрос у меня, вернее, не вопрос, а тема для работы. Иллюзия старшеклассника, что он обладает всеми знаниями, что заложено в мобильном устройстве. И поэтому, когда он уже становится не ребенком, а гражданином и приходит на рабочее место, он как работник не вполне состоятелен, потому что он не умеет без поправок сделать одну работу, заданную от начала до конца, и пускай эта работа скучная, но ее надо сделать хорошо.
Thank you very much for this. It's interesting that in the US, one of the new 21st century skills they've identified is something they call grit, determination. They realize that actually that's a real challenge for children from this generation. They can find everything they want to know immediately. They have attention spans shorter than goldfish. They need to be amused and constantly entertained. And the skill to work on something for a long period of time, even when it's difficult, is something they require. So there's a recognition, absolutely, that this is a challenge. And I think we're seeing forms of assessment developing which are exactly measuring that skill as well, that determination to keep going even when it's difficult. What's most interesting is that they do this every day when they use video games. Gaming is really interesting, gamification, because I can't think of anywhere else where a child is happy to fail and fail and fail and fail and fail and still go back and try again. There's a really interesting place where those two modalities meet, and it's something that's very intriguing in the research. If we could get kids to fail at other things as much, as easily and as often as they fail at killing aliens, then we'd be going very far in education. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Huang, do you have a question? No? Yes, but please, short one.
Okay. Thank you for just a wonderful presentation. I think that my question is related to how to just monitor just student reaction just from the point of evaluation, learning management, because you saw in many video clips related to student interaction using technologies, but I think that in terms of learning management, you do not just pay more attention to, or not just to focus on kind of formal assessment, right? How to use or extend learning management, okay?
The issue of the correct measurements is obviously an intriguing one. I was really very pleased to see in your presentation that you probably highlighted the most important one, certainly in my view, and that's student happiness. I've been working with a woman called Mrs. Q, who runs the Shanghai School District in China, and she's been introducing new technologies into their area. And we asked her the question, what are you going to measure? She said, that's really easy. I'm going to ask the students, do they want to go back to school tomorrow? And that's it. The only question she's going to ask in assessing the value of the technology is, are the students happier? Are they more engaged? Do they enjoy learning? Because fundamentally, she says, that's the most important thing to measure. If they're not engaged with the process, they're not learning. If they're not happy, we're failing them. So I think it's probably the base measure that we all need to aspire to. On a granular level, obviously, there's a lot more complexity than that, but I think it's the right place to start.
Спасибо. И маленький вопрос. Прошу.
Насколько он может быть маленьким? Махачкала, гуманитарная гимназия имени Гамзатова, Дагестан. Вот мы с большим удовольствием посмотрели клип, где очень веселый такой урок проводился. Я хочу в связи с этим задать вопрос. Учительское сообщество и взаимоотношения ученика и учителя в школе в современном восприятии, оно основано на послушании, на тихом, на тишине и так далее. Насколько чиновничество педагогическое подготовлено к таким веселым урокам? Это первый вопрос. Второй вопрос. У нас очень оснащенная гимназия в смысле технологий, и мы сталкиваемся с другой проблемой. Современная высшая школа, где готовят учителей, не оснащена такой технологией, как наша гимназия. И идя в школу, учитель побаивается этой техники, которая находится. Но дело в том, что вот такая проблема малой обеспеченности высшей школы, где готовят педагогов, я думаю, встречается во многих вузах страны. И поэтому получается такая картина: ученик более подготовлен к восприятию. У нас каждый день информатику преподают в школе. Ученик больше подготовлен, чем учитель. И еще один вопрос. Первое технологическое совершенство, которое было в школе, это была ручка, гусиное перо. Сейчас другие технологии. Но отношения, взаимоотношения учителя и ученика. На ручке он подготовлен или на компьютере? Важнее, еще очень важный вопрос возникает. Кто из них получится? Какой гражданин? Что он будет говорить? Каким он станет? И что он начнет преподносить обществу? Вот эту сторону взаимоотношения этой технологии современных учителя и ученика, мне кажется, эту сторону тоже надо изучить. Где пределы применения этой техники? Современная компьютерная технология – это всего-навсего средство, но не сама цель подготовки гражданина. В свое время Монтескьё говорил, во Франции или вообще в цивилизованном мире должны быть граждане и адвокаты. Поэтому вот граждан готовит, применяя эту технологию, очень важно. Спасибо. Я извиняюсь.
Спасибо. Получилось выступление. It's not just question, but some talk.
Один вопрос был.
Thank you for your very eloquent question. You hit on a number of issues. First of all, I agree. Technology must be the servant of pedagogy, never the other way around. I often tell groups of teachers that technology is useless, and people stop. And they say, no, technology is useless and it has no place in the classroom unless it improves learning outcomes. That's how we start. And in terms of 21st century skills like global citizenship, we have to start there. We have to decide what it is we're trying to teach, then equip people with the skills. That's where pedagogies come in. And we have to do away with this divide we have between students and teachers in their familiarity or comfort with technology, and the dichotomy we have between the level of technology sometimes in our colleges of education, which in some places is very high, and schools sometimes very low, or vice versa. We have to close that gap so that the teachers are equipped not just with the skills to bring into those new schools, but the resources they need to deliver on them. And also to ensure, as you say, and I think this is the most important point, that we start with what we're trying to teach. We want our students to be citizens of this world. It's one of the reasons why, even in our programs around literacy in sub-Saharan Africa, we've redefined literacy, this is UNESCO's suggestion, to be reading, writing, numeracy, and digital skills. Because the reality is no child on the planet can survive in the 21st century world and thrive without at least some modicum of digital skills as well.
Спасибо, thank you. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you very much.
Теперь слово предоставляется профессору Стояну Денчеву, ректора университета библиотековедения и информационных наук Софии, Болгария. Новая парадигма образования от аккредитационной квалификации к сертифицированным навыкам.
Уважаемый профессор Бадарч, профессор Хорошилов, профессор Курну, уважаемые коллеги, дамы и господа, мне очень приятно говорит по-русски несколько слов, так что мне хотелось бы сказать, что на конце 20 века я работал 3 года в Калифорнийском университете в Беркли. Там я увидел несколько, мне сказать, около 10, а там были награждены более чем 21 Нобелевский лауреат, премии Нобелевского лауреата. А сейчас, когда впервые
вошел в тот университет, я увидел там на доска почета, или как там говорится, 11 Нобелевские лауреаты. Так как сказать, в Беркли, здесь, в тот институт, НИФИ, МИФИ, пахнет науку. Я чувствую, что это часть моей биографии будет здесь, в той институт. Let's change the language to speak English. As you see, the title of my presentation is the new paradigm for education from accredited qualification to certified skills. Till now, the speaker point their presentation on the primary and the secondary school. I want to raise some problems concerning the higher education. First of all, to present myself as Professor Khoroshilov said, I'm a rector of State University of Library Study Information Technology, Sofia, Bulgaria, and I present the UNESCO Institute for Information Technologies in Education, Moscow. Very important to underline the role of UNESCO. How to change the slide? Okay. The UNESCO is underlined already. As you see on the slides, here is written that you have prepared many documents for accreditation of higher education, not only in my country, but let's say in the European Union. You receive accredited qualification, and after that, you have to prepare our students for their real skills to be implemented into society. What means accredited qualification? Maybe a lot of university professors know from Europe, and from my country especially, that you jump step by step from one accreditation process to another. You accredited our university institutionally. You accredited some program accreditation for different scientific and educational purposes. But fairly speaking, you don't need such kind of accreditation just to go around and to see what to do with our students and how they will implement into society in the real business. We need our students to say that they are masters even, and they are ready for the real world. I want to show not only my country, my university, some slides just to explain, not to make advertisement of my country. It's one of the smallest countries in the European Union, maybe one of the poorest, fairly speaking, from one side, but from another side, we have a kiss from a god, for the nature, from the peoples, and from all which have been done from my country. It's my university, not as a building, not as a matter of education, but as a matter of preparing our students. It is using this new information technology. That's me, of course, it's not a university. I want to show that my university is a member of following organization professionals which give us the possibilities to make a touch with the real business, to make a touch with the real life. That's the last stage here is look like advertisement that we are guardian of knowledge, but everyone in university is possible to claim such kind of activities. I want to say some words concerning the real paradigm, the going from accredited qualification to certified skills. The European Union Framework Program for Research and Innovation Horizon 2020, oriented at development of the education and science in the European Union, aims at building capacities and developing innovative ways of connecting science to society, raising the criteria and mechanism for increasing the role of Europe in the world competitiveness environment to a qualitatively new level. The responsible government institution and factors in European Union came to the conclusion, I think, that eventually they have to follow the recommendations and experience, the years of experience and the best practices of UNESCO in the field of education and science. At this year's UNESCO Global Educational Skill Forum in Dubai in March was formulated, I think, a new key goal qualitatively changing the world educational paradigm. This paradigm could be synthesized in the following sentences, like the title of my paper, from accredited qualification to the certified skills. One of the real possibilities for realization of these global educational goals concerning not only the primary, secondary, but in the higher education level, is establishment of technological scientific parks and center for excellence, ensuring the connection between education, science, and business, providing the right environment for implementation of the strategic educational priorities and the financial support for innovative projects. As I mentioned, one of these is the science park, a strategic information priorities. There is given the general definition of this science park organization and the structure, I shall say, which have a very important role for not only for the developing the new stage of education, but developing a new stage for preparing our students for the real world. There is definition of science park given by the organization which is responsible for scientific parts, and organization which is responsible for student university scientific parts. Here you have seen some very important stage of organizing university and business cooperation concerning the large company, small company, university researcher, university institution, and of course public support. As I mentioned before, there is the International Association of Science Park, which is one of very innovative organizations all over the world, and Association of University Research Park, which give a support from universities which have aims and education just to start to create some science park for the cooperation between the business, science, and education. I have to mention some facts concerning the first science park organized in Stanford University in 1951. The second one have been in Cornell Business University. The United States have the Cambridge Science Park established in 1917. Germany in Ulm. They have organized already, and they develop very hardly their science park. Maybe happened something. Germany, yeah. Finland. Our friend Professor Tapio knows very well the organization of this park and how the park is helping for education of students, more than 40,000, and professionals which will be ready. And they are ready for a real life. I skip Estonian and Romanian sky parks. There is some question we have to answer before to start to create such kind of science park, how they should be built from scratch or having the infrastructure top down, down top. Different questions which give us a different answers, supporting the preparing the students for the real life. Concerning the connection between the business and education and the science in the paradigm, this new paradigm from qualified accredited qualification to the certified skills. I mentioned before that there is two very strong issue which will help for changing the paradigm. And first was the scientific part, and second is the center of excellence. I want to show you one example of creating such kind of centers which have been supported by the European program Horizon 2020. Objectives to establish such kind of center is these which are given on the slide, but I want to underline that the overall objective of the project Intellex is to establish a new center of excellence and to position it as a strong research and innovative hub of national, European and international level. Special attention will be paid on the criteria at future internet and web, which has transformational impact on society and all industries and provides enormous opportunities for economic growth. The proposal provides a long-term vision and strategy and clear action plan for capacity building and further growth of Center of Excellence. It aims to qualify as an associate partner of the Ethic Lab for Southeastern Europe and Balkans. The Center for Excellence will cooperate with many regional, national, and international partners and shareholders, including, of course, citizens. The project also aims strongly contributing for the successful implementation of the Horizon 2020 strategy and national plan for development of countries member of European Union. In addition, the Center of Excellence aims at building regional research and innovative capacity in order to firmly support, for example, Sofia municipality in its efforts for development of Sofia as a smart city. Specific area of implementation of this Center of Excellence is shown on the table and the slide, and I see that it's very easy to understand the role of this center for future development of such kind of structure, scientific and business structure working simultaneously. The main partners for this specific Center for Excellence is given on the slide. Knowledge Triangle for creating such kind of center of excellence is given as an innovation, research and education. And here is given one very simple model for implementing such kind of center of excellence in the society. It's not only simple to provide the vision of a new paradigm from accredited qualification to certified skills, but it's just a new way of thinking. I want to underline something which has been given before at the beginning of our conference, telling by Professor Kurnu. He said it's not only enough to change the computers, it's on ITs, but we have to change the culture of thinking. I think this new paradigm is just a way to change the culture of thinking. Concerning the so-called distant education, which is a part of old, I think, paradigm, I want to share with you my experience, having in mind that one of my colleagues before just said that one teacher has educated more than 120 students. I have seen in Italy and Spain that from the building, let's say, the room with 140 or 150 square meter, have been educated more than 60,000 students. I think it's not the future of education. You have to think about not to have educational market just to sell in parents' diplomas, but to have the place for social contacts between the students, which is one of the definition of the universities. I think to stop right now and just to invite you in Sofia, Bulgaria, in the end of this month, which in our UNESCO chair, you organize a workshop named Educational Quality and Challenges for Teachers in a Digital Networking World. I welcome you and want to thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you. Спасибо большое.